Hey, good morning. This is Faith Baptist Church's open house. We designed this to be able to allow people that aren't a regular attender of Faith Baptist Church to find out what we're like, give you a little bit of flavor of our music, give you a little bit of flavor of what we do. Our ministries are highlighted. We would love for you to consider maybe being a part of us. If not, just to know, you know, what we are and what we do. And I want to share with you just a little bit about actually what we are deep down, what we actually teach and what we believe, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel, it's kind of interesting. The word gospel just simply means good news. And we've all received good news and bad news. When I was growing up, one of my favorite television shows, thank God for the fans, one of my favorite television shows was Hee Haw. Now, I just turned 60 years old this past week, so some of you may not even know what Hee Haw is. But back in the late 60s, early 70s, it was what you think it is. It was a comedy country show, variety show, and they would have all these comedians on there, country comedians, and they would highlight good, you may not know there is such a thing, good country music. And they had these little skits, and there was one particular skit that they had pretty much every week. And one of the fellows named Archie Campbell, he acted like he was a barber in a small little town. And he would have different guests in. And actually, he had athletes and other people that came in. Well, one time he had Roy Clark come in. And so what he did was he said, "Hey, Roy," he says, "I've got some bad news." This is one of the skits. "I've got some bad news." And he said, "What is it?" And he says, "Well, my great uncle died." And he said, "Well, that is bad news." He says, "No, that's good news. When my great uncle died, he left me $50,000. "That's really good news." "No, that's bad news, because after the IRS got finished with it, I only had $25,000. He says, "Well, that is bad news." He says, "No, that's good news, because I took the $25,000 and I bought me an airplane." He says, "Well, that's good news." He says, "No, that's bad news. I took the airplane out the first time and I was flying around, went upside down, I fell out of the airplane." He said, "That's bad news." He said, "No, that's good news. As I was falling out of the airplane, I looked down the ground, and there's a big haystack, and I was heading right for it." He says, "That's good news." He says, "No, that's bad news." He says, "Up out of the haystack, there was a pitchfork." He says, "Ooh, that's bad news." He says, "No, that's good news." He said, "I missed the pitchfork." He says, "Woo." He says, "That's good news." He says, "No, that's bad news. I missed the haystack, too." And so we've all had those times where, you know, you hear good news, and the good news has a little bit of bad news in it, and we've heard bad news, and sometimes it turns into good news. And isn't it right that life just goes up and down? One of the great men of the Old Testament, Solomon, he said, there's a season for everything and a time to every purpose. There's a time to be born, and there's a time to die. There's a time to laugh, and then there's a time to weep. And life kind of has its ups and its downs. There's good news and there's bad news. And that's what the gospel is. The gospel tells us the good news. So what I want to do is I just want to talk just a little bit, just really short, about the good news and the bad news of life. First of all, the first good news. The first good news is that heaven is an absolutely free gift. It's not earned or deserved. Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, if you want to look there, but I have it up here. The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Apostle Paul actually said it's the gift of God. God gives it to us. You can't earn it. You can't do enough good stuff to get it. It is a gift. Once you buy something, it ceases to be a gift. In heaven, eternal life, we sang about eternal life, it is an absolutely free gift. That's the first good news. But there's some bad news. And the bad news is that every one of us are sinners. All of us. And we can't save ourselves. We've all done something bad. We've all said something bad. We've all done something bad. We've all thought something bad. And I understand, that's just part of human nature. That's just part of, we do things on accident, and sometimes we do things on purpose. And we've all messed up. Again, Romans chapter 3 and verse 23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all messed up. Does that make us right? I just turned 60 years old last Monday. I added this up. If I only did one wrong thing a day. Okay? Only one. Today, I will have committed my 21,921st sin. Almost 20, whatever your age is, you can figure out how many wrong things you've done if you've only done one wrong thing a day. Now, here's the deal, though. God actually says not only is it wrong to do something bad, the Bible actually says it's wrong not to do something as right. When you see something that you should do and you can do and you refuse to do the good, that's wrong too. It's not just the bad stuff that we mess up with. It's the good stuff that we really haven't done. And that's the really, really bad news. But there's good news. The good news is that God loves you. And God doesn't want to punish you. He doesn't. The most famous verse in the Bible, "For God so loved the world." 1 John says that God is love. The verse we have up here, Jeremiah 31, "I have loved you with an everlasting love." You have never been loved like God loves. God loves you more than anybody. Because here's the deal. God knows how much you've sinned. God knows what you did on accident, not on purpose. It just happened to come out. And God also knows what you did on purpose, and God knows what you thought about doing but didn't have an opportunity to do it. And God still loves you. God loves you a lot. He cares about you. He cares about every heartache you go through. He cares about every inconsistency that's in your life. He cares about the people who have hurt you, the people who have turned against you and harmed you. And he loves you and cares about you. So he loves you. But there's some bad news. Even though God loves you and doesn't want to punish you, God is just, and he has to punish sin. You know, some people get this idea that if God is a good God, he won't punish us. But actually, just because God is a good God means he must punish us. Suppose I went to Lenawee County Courthouse, and I was accused of committing one crime, and I did it. I mean, not 21,921 crimes, but suppose I just committed one crime, and I did it. They caught me red-handed. They caught me coming out of the bank with the bags of money, and they arrested me, and they had the pictures. And I got up in the front, and the police all come, and everybody knows I did it. But suppose one of the judges says, "Greg, I know you. You're a good guy. You're a religious person. And because you're such a good guy, I'm going to let you off. I am not going to do anything to you. You are free to go." Would that be a good judge? No. I mean, it doesn't matter how many good things I've done. If I've done something wrong, you know, I'm wrong. And even though God loves you and doesn't want to punish anyone, he has to punish sin. He has to punish the wrong. He is a just and a good God. And that's the bad news. We will all face the consequences. You see, we cannot do enough good things to override the bad things. Another misconception people have is that when we stand in front of God, it's going to be like one of those seesaws or teeter-totters, you know, and God's going to put all our good things on one side, and God's going to put all the bad things on the other side, and whichever one weighs the most, you know, some of the really bad things and the really good things, and whichever one weighs the most, that's what's going to either get me into heaven or send me to hell. And that doesn't make sense. It's because heaven is a perfect place, and nothing wrong can go there, otherwise it won't be perfect anymore. Doesn't that make sense? You know, if my wife cleans the floor and I walk in with my dirty shoes, guess what? I'm in trouble, and the floor's not clean anymore. And so if sin gets into heaven, it's not heaven anymore. God cannot allow sin to get there, so he has to punish it. And if we have it, we're in big trouble. And that's the really, really bad news. God must punish sin. But this is where the good news becomes the best news, and this is why it's the gospel. And that is because Jesus died on a cross to pay for our sins and provide a place for us in heaven. That's what he did. Christians, you think about this, I mean, and I'm just being honest, isn't it kind of morbid that Christians celebrate the death of somebody? I mean, look around here, we have crosses. In most Christian churches, you find crosses. It doesn't matter what denomination it is. Why do we honor a cross? Why do we honor an object of death? It's because Jesus died as my substitute. There's a verse in the Bible, Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6, says, "All we like sheep have gone astray." That's where the whole sin, the whole wrongdoing, we've all done it. It says we've turned everyone to his own way. That's kind of our own selfishness. That's just part of who we are. "And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all." On Jesus. God allowed Jesus to die on a cross to pay for our sins. And so that's the good news. The good news is that I have an opportunity to have my sins completely removed, and I have an opportunity to have a place in heaven because of what Jesus did for me. And he didn't just do it for me. I'm going to finish the first verse I quoted, John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." The great apostle Paul said, "Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved." That's prayer. To call on God to save me. So regardless of whether you come here every Sunday or whether maybe this is your first time, and I sure appreciate you being here, you might say, okay, what do I have to do to get this eternal life, to get this sin forgiven? What do I have to do? It is fairly simply explained in the Bible. First thing we have to do when we pray, we talk to God, is admit that we're a sinner. Just admit it. Have you ever been around somebody that just didn't admit they were ever wrong? Yeah. Don't point at them, you know, don't nudge them, you know, because sometimes we're married to them, or sometimes there are teenagers. Teenagers never do anything wrong. Sometimes there are parents. Parents never do anything wrong. But God knows it. You're not telling God anything new. You're not going to tell something God say, "Oh, I didn't know that." So you admit that you're a sinner. The Bible calls that confess. To say, "God, I know it. It's wrong. And not only sin, but I'm a sinner." To admit that you're a sinner. To believe in Jesus. Believe that Jesus is God's Son, and that he did die on a cross, and he rose again. The Bible says if we believe that and we confess it, or we tell God that, he will save us. So we believe in what Jesus has done. But that's not quite enough. Admit that we've sinned and we're a sinner, believe in Jesus, and then commit our life to him. To make a commitment, a personal commitment to him. And that involves not only making a commitment to God, that involves turning from our sin. You know, back in 1981, August the 8th, I made a commitment to a very young girl. And I said, "I will spend the rest of my life with you." And the preacher had me say this. He said, "Turning from all others, cleave unto you so long as you both shall live." Guess what I said?
I do.
Yeah. In other words, I not only wanted Judy, I had to leave everybody else. Not like there was a big long line at the time, but I had to make that commitment. And when you make a commitment to Jesus, it means, "Jesus, I am turning from my sin. I no longer want sin to reign over me, but I am turning to you. I am surrendering my life to you." That's what it takes. It's not going to church a certain amount of times. It's not given to a good cause. It's not volunteering. It's not quitting this habit or that habit. It's not anything you can really do. Because honestly, it's already done. Jesus did it for you. You simply accept it. It is a gift. It's a gift that is offered, but just like any gift, you have to receive it. And if you're here this morning, and regardless of where you're at in your life and what your journey is, if you will pray and you will admit your sin and that you believe in Jesus and you commit your life to Jesus, he will save your soul. Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Let's bow our heads just for a few minutes. And I just want to give you this opportunity to do that. You know, a lot of times we don't pause and take time. But I want to give you kind of this opportunity to invite Jesus Christ to be in your life. Your prayer can simply be, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. And I know I've done wrong. And I believe in you. And I commit my life to you. I surrender my life to you as my Lord and Savior. Just take a few minutes to ask God to do that for you. Invite Jesus Christ to be in your life, to surrender your life to him.